The pandemic is forcing innovation. John Yang explores a competition to make better ventilators. It's part of our breakthrough series covering invention.
Why don't we bring you, bring the computer over, and they can give you a tour of the machine as it stands.
This is how a team of Maine high school students and recent graduates came up with a ventilator design during the pandemic, a shaky video conference.
It's just a very easy way to hit and use actual water.
Baxter Academy engineering teacher John Amory assembled the team, including 15-year-old sophomore Emily McCool.
Amory gave us a list of resources and told us to learn as much about ventilators as we could.
We were thinking about what kind of ventilators could be built, you know, distributed. So, we had to have kits so that they could be sent to people. So we designed a ventilator that could be put together with about four hand tools, two crescent wrenches, an Allen key set, and a screwdriver.
They're part of the COVID-19 Challenge, a global virtual competition to design ventilators that can be built quickly and cheaply with readily available components. In the early days of the COVID pandemic, there were fears, largely unrealized so far for a variety of reasons, that U.S. hospitals would run out of ventilators.
We are searching the globe for additional ventilators. You cannot find them. Every state is trying to get them. Other countries are trying to get them.
Dr. Richard Boyer, an anesthesiology resident at Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston, thought up the COVID-19 challenge in March while self-isolating with his wife, Emily, after he was exposed to a coronavirus patient.
I got a little bored and I...
He got bored on day three. So, just so you know, it didn't take that long.
I used to be a medical device designer, and I use ventilators every day. So when I started learning about the ventilator shortages, it became very natural to me to want to work on the engineering side of this issue.
Emily, who works in education, is head of operations, organizing the more than 20 MGH residents running the competition.
All of the residents were taking on roles and responsibilities that are not part of being a doctor. So we have, you know, one person who's managing our social media, the other person who's managing the website, also doing it without the ability of being in the same room.
There were 213 entries from more than 40 countries. A team of medical and technical experts selected seven finalists. One of them, a small team in Scotland led by Ross Hunter.
I did not expect to be a finalist. I was truly surprised.
Hunter, CEO of a company that makes luxury eco accommodations, based this design on a pet project he's been tinkering with for years, a commercial coffee machine.
I actually already had a coffee machine prototype, and instead of water, I started putting air into it, and you know, I didn't know what to expect, but it looked like promising results from there. So that then led me on to the quest to make a ventilator out of a coffee machine, effectively.
That kind of outside-the-box thinking was key for another finalist, the students at Baxter Academy, a public charter school in Portland, Maine, Emily McCool.
We didn't have this preconceived notion of what a ventilator should look like. My teacher, Amory, talks a lot about groupthink. Our brain gets stuck on the idea of what we want to do before we start exploring something that could potentially be a better option.
And the key to open innovation, I think, is having people that don't come from your field apply their insights. A group that you mentioned from Scotland that created their ventilator from what was initially a coffee maker, I don't imagine that an anesthesiologist or a typical medical device company would ever have looked at that design, but here he's developed a design that's very feasible as a safe ventilator and very economical.
All the entered designs are free for anyone to download in hopes they help developing countries where ventilators are in short supply. As the medical community gains experience with COVID-19, some physicians have begun using ventilators less often in certain types of cases. But the devices remain a key part of treatment.
There's no other way to ventilate these patients safely other than with a ventilator. And they are critical parts of our ICU.
Ventilators used in U.S. hospitals can cost between $20,000 to $50,000, and the federal government is spending an average of $15,000 each to add about 200,000 ventilators to the national stockpile. the cost of these designs?
The ventilator that we have now, we built for about $2,500, and that includes the price of a 3D printer that you would use to print off some of the parts.
Very cost effective. I mean, the materials for the parts behind me, it's less than $700.
The COVID-19 challenge presented challenges to learn from.
My knowledge of ventilators was zero at the beginning of this, and it has been one of the sharpest learning curves I've ever encountered in my life. I've literally nights and days were spent reading up on medical journals, finding out about how these work, why these work.
So what's interesting is a lot of the things that were stumbling blocks, I think, led to better design overall. For example, we have a low pressure regulator that drops the pressure down. And that was delayed in terms of getting to us. So we were using a scuba, a $25 scuba regulator that you can buy at any dive shop.
And it also served to inspire.
We're dealing with so much distress in the world, from economic stress, from political and social stress, from obviously the stress on our healthcare system and people losing loved ones every day. For people to commit themselves to so much to something, to a goal, and to see it come to fruition is incredibly inspiring.
We were doing our presentation, and I was thinking they've heard rocket engineers and PhD candidates speaking, and I'm a 15-year-old. I just learned how to start driving a car. I try not to think of it as we're pitted against each other. But being in the same collaborative space as those voices is a really great opportunity.
And even if neither of these teams is the winner announced on Wednesday, they have already gained and given so much. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm John Yang. Starting from this side, we take the